Minister of Economy Nathia Turnava announces that low-cost airline Wizz Air will resume flights from Kutaisi in March. She declared that after the government meeting, according to her, low-cost Hungarian airlines would operate 45 flights a week to 20 destinations from late March.
This information is not fully confirmed by Wizz Air itself. As the head of Wizz Air Communications, András Radó, told BMG, they applied for air frequencies. However, it is too early to talk about a specific date for flight resumption from Kutaisi. The company cannot name an exact date as it depends on COVID regulations, which are still in place around the world, and the demand on flights is still low due to restrictions.
Deputy Mayor of Tbilisi, Andrea Basilaia, declares that over 2 million Georgian lari will be allocated from the central budget, which provides subsidizing small and medium restaurants in Tbilisi. Over 400 restaurants will benefit with that financial assistance.
David Mrelashvili, Georgian neurologist working in the United States, donated a refrigerator operating at minus 80 degrees Celsius to the Gahati region for Pfizer vaccine. Another refrigerator, which is also donated by him, is currently in Luger lab, and it will be used for that region which needs it most.
This is The Checkpoints, anchored and co-hosted by Elena Kvanchilashvili. Good evening, Elena. And myself, I'm Georgi Sakadze. We're here in the Forbes studio to talk about business and economics.
Which makes you know that it is 10 p.m. sharp. And let's start with our exclusive, Georgi, and that's the interview with Standard & Poor's that our journalist Shotat Kashelashvili managed to conduct. The reason for that was the update of the sovereign rating that this influential rating agency provided for Georgia on the back of pandemic and 6.1% economic downturn. Standard & Poor's kept the rating unchanged to Georgia, but changed its outlook to negative. Here is the exclusive interview with RT Sakuya, S&P Global rating analyst, that Shotat Kashelashvili conducted for us.
In 2020, we had a very serious crisis in our country, and our GDP dropped with 6.1%. So what were the main drivers of your decision to not decrease Georgian sovereign credit ranking despite this crisis?
Firstly, good afternoon, Shota, and thanks for having me on. We published our most recent report on Georgia last week on the 26th, and in that we have affirmed the ratings with a negative outlook. So I think the first thing to highlight is that we have revised the outlook downwards, so negative from stable before. Now, there are a few reasons why we affirmed the ratings. Like you said, the Georgian economy did have a very significant contraction of 6% in its real GDP. But of course, Georgia is not the only economy in the world at this point of time facing a pandemic with a stress on its economy. We do take into account that the authorities did have some space to undertake sizable counter-cyclical policy in the face of this very large economic shock. And there was a very sizable fiscal and monetary policy response that cushioned the economy to some extent from the blow of the pandemic. Very importantly, in our ratings consideration, while there was a loss of foreign earnings, particularly from tourism receipts and a fall in FDI, we did not see foreign exchange reserves coming under pressure during the year. Now, this was, of course, possible because of loans from international financial institutions. So even though we saw an economic adjustment, we didn't really see a balance of payments crisis for Georgia. Now, the flip side of this is that while external liquidity was preserved and we didn't see a crisis on the balance of payments front, the economy and the government both are a lot more leveraged now following this, following 2020, particularly in terms of foreign debt. And we think that at the same time, even though there has been an increase in leverage, Georgia's capacity to earn in foreign exchange over the medium term at least has been diminished because of the outlook for both tourism and foreign direct investment. So we affirmed the ratings, but taking these factors into account, we did revise the outlook to negative.
Yes, and as S&P has mentioned, Georgian economy has balance of payments vulnerabilities, including economy's import dependency and sizable external liabilities. And in 2021, our debt to GDP ratio has exceeded 60%. So do you see any major risks from increased debt levels, and what would be your recommendations on the state budget? What can be done to lower the deficit?
So I think the first thing to say is that, yes, we do see higher risks from Georgia's increased general government debt. So firstly, just in the past year, debt has increased by more than 20 percentage points. And we think that it will rise further to about 70% of GDP in 2021. This is a very substantial increase from the 40% of GDP that government debt stood at in 2019. And in general, from our point of view, higher levels of debt do imply reduced room for fiscal policy maneuver. We also think that other characteristics of debt are quite relevant. We think, for example, that the higher the proportion of debt that is denominated in foreign currency, that is the currency which the government does not necessarily have in its local currency, that increases risks to the debt profile. Now, in Georgia's case, that percentage is fairly large. It is at 80%. And whenever we see a fairly sharp depreciation of the lari against other currencies like the dollar or the euro, we do tend to see an increase in the debt profile. On your question on what Georgia can do to reduce its debt stock, I'm afraid at S&P we don't really offer policy advice. We are not in a position to offer this to governments, but we do observe that GDP that tends to be the tax base on which governments, or rather the base on which governments tax, usually changes in growth or improvements in the structure of economies provide a more sustainable footing for debt reduction.
And as S&P has mentioned in the report, you suspect slight depreciation of lari foreign exchange rate, and one US dollar would be 3.5 at the end of the year. Also, you suspect depreciation in medium-term future. What is the reasoning for this projection, and do you think that NBG should provide additional FX interventions on the market?
Since we don't offer policy advice, I cannot really say what the NBG should do. What we have seen the NBG doing, of course, is it has an inflation targeting mandate. And whenever it sees a risk to its inflation target on a forward-looking basis, it tends to intervene if a depreciation is threatening the pass-through of imported inflation into the domestic inflation print. So I think that probably is going to remain a feature in Georgia. But then again, at the same time, it depends on the level of FX reserves that the central bank also has. So in previous years, in the last few years, we have, before the pandemic, we did see the National Bank of Georgia actually proactively increase its foreign reserves, which did provide it the space to actually intervene and sell foreign exchange to defend the lari in 2020. For the depreciation, we see Georgia running a structural current account deficit and generally being a user of foreign exchange, which is why we see pressures on the exchange rate on a forward-looking basis.
And while other countries have eased their monetary policy to increase economic output, Georgian economy has more serious challenges that are linked to currency fluctuations and inflational expectations. So that is why we have tightened the monetary policy. What are your expectations about it? And should we expect additional tightening in this area?
Again, I think the central bank takes into account not just the needs of in growth. It has to look at inflation because it has an inflation targeting mandate. And one of the things for Georgia, one of the features is that the pass-through of depreciation and imported inflation tends to have quite an impact on inflation. So I think that that is something that the central bank tends to look at. But then there's also the factor of dollarization. And the central bank wants to prevent a fairly rapid increase in the debt service for those loans, for example, that are denominated in foreign exchange. And whenever you have a depreciation, that debt service can rise. And so I think that this sort of it constrains monetary policy a little bit in Georgia, because the central bank not only has to take into account growth considerations, it also has to take into account what the effect depreciation has on dollarization, not just on inflation, and what it does to the debt service, and ultimately how that feeds back into growth and into price stability.
In Georgia, currently we see an increased uncertainty about vaccine rollout. So in spite of national targets to inoculate 60% of our population, the first doses of vaccines have not yet arrived in the country. And Georgian government is talking about some kind of miscommunication with international COVAX platform. In your opinion, what effect can it have on economic growth prospects of Georgia, the vaccination rate, and what effect can it have on tourism inflows in country?
So we think that in general, countries that can roll out vaccines sooner successfully are going to be able to restart their domestic economies at a faster pace while keeping infections in check. Now, small delays are less likely to be a concern. What we identify as a bigger impediment right now to vaccine rollouts is just the supply constraints globally, and matched with a very strong demand across the world for vaccines and vaccine hesitancy in some economies, including in Georgia, where people are not necessarily sure they would want to take the vaccine. Now, the ability of most governments, not just in Georgia, to deliver on their fairly ambitious targets of having large percentages of their populations inoculated seem to be challenged at this point of time, with the considerations that we just discussed. But then again, we kind of have been seeing that emerging markets in particular have had a slower rollout of vaccines. Now, in Georgia's case, with the vaccines that it has contracted through COVAX, and just looking at the distribution schedule that COVAX has published, only about 3% of the population will be vaccinated in the first half of 2021, as things currently stand. So from the tourism point of view, and even from the domestic economy point of view, it might be harder for governments, including in Georgia, to restart and reopen their economies on a more sustainable footing while large portions of their population remain unvaccinated.
And to follow up on the tourism sector, the mobility and tourism were the main victims of the pandemic, and Georgia saw tremendous fall in tourism revenues. In your opinion, do you see tourism dependency as a potential risk for economies? Would it be reasonable to think about more diversification in economic sectors?
I think in general, we do see the concentration in any particular sector or industry, whether it is tourism, in some countries it is hydrocarbons, or in any one particular area, as a ratings negative, generally, because it sort of puts the economy at risk when an episode like this happens. I think in general, our opinion is that diversification And multiple revenue sources are a good thing, and the lack of diversification and concentration, it tends to expose economies to more vulnerabilities in adverse times. I think there have been efforts from Georgian policymakers to diversify the economy over time, but some of these areas will also likely be affected. For instance, in our outlook, we think that direct investment inflows are going to be impacted, which in turn impacts some of the investment projects that the government was hoping to get in place. And the future of Georgia as a regional hub and those aspirations might have to be tempered a little bit given the new realities.
Mm-hmm. And Georgian government plans to refinance the $500 million bonds that were issued in 2011. Do you have any communication with Georgian government about this issue? The refinancing is planned to be in April of 2021.
Well, I think the stated objective of the government is to refinance this bond. They were initially planning to pay it down. Honestly, they have the buffers at this point of time to select either of those options. Yes, I think that the conditions are present in the market for them to approach the markets, or if they choose, they can also pay it down. It is a policy decision that they are considering themselves, but I believe that they have stated that they intend to refinance the bond through fresh issuance, rather through issuance.
My next question will be about the political situation in country. So as S&P has mentioned, there is increased uncertainty on the political side in Georgia. What effect can it have on Georgia's investment climate and economic growth?
Yeah, I think that's a very good question, Shota. I want to flag that firstly, political instability on its own does not affect credit ratings. From our point of view, what matters is the impact of political instability on policy, right? Of course, when you have frequent crises in the political sphere, they do tend to take time and attention away from reforms. And in our report for Georgia, we do flag that the political volatility that we've seen in some form or the other for the past couple of years now can slow reform momentum. It can also hurt, the perception with foreign investors. It is a risk for growth. It is a risk for financing. Investors tend to seek out stability and predictability for their investments, and they like to see the rule of law being implemented. So far, I have to say that we don't really see very big reversals of previously implemented reforms, which have actually helped Georgia to gain its reputation as a good place to do business in the region. But we are increasingly concerned that there is a tendency towards centralization of power. We wonder in what direction that will go. Like I said, we haven't sort of really seen that translate very significantly into policy action or inaction so far.
Mm-hmm. So as Georgian government has publicly announced, their aim is to increase country's sovereign rating to investment grade level. Since it took almost 8 years to increase the ranking from BB minus to BB, how many years of reforms and growth can it take to further increase credit score? And what are the main indicators you look at? Is it the GDP per capita levels, institutional stability, economic growth, or balance of payments?
Again, good question, Shota. I think the first thing to flag really is that at this point of time, we have a negative outlook on Georgia's ratings, on Georgia's sovereign ratings. So at this point, we see a higher probability of a downgrade rather than an upgrade, right? And to your question on the time it takes to get to investment grade, now different sovereigns take different amounts of time to reach investment grade. There are no sort of fixed time frames of when, if at all, a sovereign rating would get there. Now, from the ratings point of view, some of the important things that we look at, we review the role of policy in delivering solid macroeconomic outcomes, like we just discussed in your previous question. We look at that very closely. And the policy of determining good macroeconomic outcomes also includes a prudent fiscal policy. We look at the economy's income levels, we look at growth prospects. So these two are the pillars and very important parts of the rating, the structure of the economy, its growth prospects, and policy effectiveness. But we also do consider the balance of payments. We look at the financing of the current account deficit, if the country is running one, its prospects of paying down its external debt, reserve adequacy. We look at the success of monetary policy in achieving low levels of inflation. We look at the government's debt profile, so including the stock of debt and other characteristics of its debt. Those are the areas that we tend to look at. From Georgia's point of view, the move towards investment grade, hypothetically, for that to happen, we would have to see a fairly substantial shift in Georgia's income levels. And this is likely to require a shift in its growth model away from the currently relatively lower value add to a higher value addition. And we would also have to see some of the external vulnerabilities that we identify. We would like to see those diminished. So, for example, we would like to see a reduction, a sustainable reduction in the current account deficit, a reduction in the external financing needs the economy has, and coupled with a rise in its export earnings and higher external buffers through foreign exchange reserves.
You can see, Georgi, how much is dependent on the vaccination process, which is a key to opening up the economy and lifting the lockdowns so that the economy has the room to breathe. And I have a subtitle, by the way, in this week's editor's note for BMG, handling Pfizer as an example of you name it.
Yeah, excellent one. And I read it out. And so did several hundred of our readers. Thank you so much for following us, both on BMG and Forbes. And let us then remind, Elena, our viewers and followers, why you emphasize especially Pfizer in that context.
Yes, sure, Georgi. The thing is that despite what the officials have told us so far, it's still the fact that the vaccination process has not picked up from late February as promised. Georgia was set to receive at least 29,000 doses of Pfizer through the COVAX platform, but it couldn't. By the end of February, representative of the Ministry of Health and Epidemiologists started talks that Georgia would receive the Pfizer vaccine in early March and elaborated on different reasons for the delay, one being the global shortage and the other being the additional transportation and some other conditions that the producer company had presented Georgia in what seemed a surprise move for the government. A different explanation came from one of the news agencies in Georgia, quoting the COVAX platform itself, that it had delivered a vaccine in February to those countries that had adjusted to the set criteria for handling Pfizer vaccine.
Yes, and the health ministry responded to this information on different levels.
Yes, Georgi, correct. First, the minister, Ekaterina Tikaradze, did not rule out the possibility to sue COVAX platform for breaching the agreement, but then later her deputy, Tamar Gabuni, assured us that the misunderstanding with COVAX was cleared and the cooperation continued. The same day after the Interagency Coordination Council meeting had ended, head of NCDC, Amiran Gamkrelidze, stated that the agreed amount of Pfizer, 29,250 doses, would reach Georgia soon. Currently, what we know is that the government is in a waiting mode for a phone call for COVAX and Pfizer to make the final agreements. But Georgi, before coming to the checkpoints, it was already announced that Tamar Gabuni received
she
this
confirms.
Call. Yes, she confirms that the call
so
has
we have
already
the final
been.
Date.
Yes, we have the final date. Yes.
Okay, then we can proceed. So far, it's confirmed that 29,500 vaccines, which is around 14,000 actually, including mm-hmm. some losses, which is natural losses, while the vaccination is just for our medicines, it's for our nurses, it's for our doctors and those
risk groups.
Main
correct. Risk groups, yes.
But also we have AstraZeneca confirmed
as
well.
Yes, that's true, and that's a very good emphasis, Georgi. We can now show the document from COVAX itself, which says that Georgia is set to receive 129,600 doses and 29,250 doses of Pfizer by the end of May 2021. What Deputy Minister Tamar Gabunia said on Friday that I was just mentioning was that the Pfizer vaccine might reach Georgia even earlier. The specific date was set on March 22, so that's the new date for now. Meanwhile, we can watch Forbes' short video, Georgi, about how Ghana became the first nation to receive vaccines from the World Health Organization-backed COVAX
initiative.
Good luck,
Ghana. Ghana has become the first country in the world to receive COVID-19 vaccines from the World Health Organization-backed COVAX initiative that promises to deliver shots to poorer nations, as health experts around the world raised concerns about inequitable availability of vaccines that they warn may prolong the pandemic. As part of Wednesday's delivery, Ghana received 600,000 doses of the AstraZeneca Oxford vaccine, which has been licensed and manufactured by the Serum Institute of India, the COVAX initiative announced in a press release. Ghana was picked to be the first recipient of the COVAX-funded shots after it outlined its national rollout plan and proved that its healthcare teams and cold chain equipment were adequately prepared, the Washington Post reported. Ghana's vaccine rollout will begin on March 2 in phases, starting with health workers, people older than 60, those with pre-existing conditions and other frontline workers. Highlighting the inequitable rollout of the vaccine so far, WHO Director General Tedros Adhanom Ghebreyesus noted Tuesday that 210 million doses of vaccine have been administered globally, but half of those are in just two countries, while more than 200 countries are yet to administer a single dose.
And then let's see what the communication with epidemiologists and experts could look like. And let's watch together another very interesting video with Dr. Tony Fauci and President Joseph Biden in person.
This is the spike protein. This is the protein of coronavirus. When you see the coronavirus, it has these spikes that come out, which is the reason they call it corona, for spikes of a crown of a. Okay? Now, this is what your body is currently making antibodies against. When you got vaccinated with the mRNA, because the vaccine that you got, that you're going to hear about in a couple of minutes from the people who actually made it, is an mRNA, which is the coding component that tells the body to make a protein. You had this injected in your arm. It then started to make this protein, which is the spike protein. Now, this has to be in the right shape and conformation. You're going to hear about that from one of our scientists. If it's in the wrong conformation, your body's going to make a very poor immune response. In the right conformation, it makes a really, really good response.
Great video, Georgi, indeed, with a very notable caption as well. Dr. Fauci gives a science lesson. And then President Biden's quote, when I said I would listen to the scientists as president, I meant it. Such a great message for the coordinated work that needs to be done to finally defeat COVID-19 and the pandemic, which to this day is unfortunately taking lives.
Indeed, Elena, but Dr. Fauci, in reality, he missed these lessons and these public lessons during Trump administration.
Yes, you can see during the video.
He was willing to do so. But meanwhile, Georgian delegation had its first international physical event. Georgian delegation engaged in after a one-year pandemic gap within the Enterprise Georgia's export direction initiation and the USAID agriculture program support. Georgian companies participated finally in the Gulf Food 2021 exhibition.
Georgi, if I'm not mistaken, this is the exhibition which is traditionally held in Dubai,
correct,
United Arab Emirates, and is visited by an average of 92,000 visitors annually. This
correct
is what sources.
Correct, exactly. Elena, it's one of the largest and the most important events in the food and beverage sector industry. Almost all types of product manufacturers can participate in Gulf Food except for the manufacturers of alcohol beverages.
Yes, and 14 Georgian companies are participating in the exhibition with the support of the agency Enterprise Georgia. Georgi, do you know what were the criteria that the companies were selected based on?
These companies were selected based on criteria developed and approved by the agency itself and its co-financing mechanism. The rest is in the interview, exclusive one again, with Mikhail Hidurelli. He's the head of Enterprise Georgia.
Misha, many thanks again for the, shortest notice ever. You're again with us. Thank you so much on behalf of the Checkpoints and our Forbes studio. Tell me a bit more, why are we gonna check with the participants themselves through our media channels? We might need your help, but before that, it was quite important thing to mention, even by your agency itself, that after a year delay, 14 Georgian companies participated in Gulf Food Exhibition. So please tell me, it's quite an important issue, how Georgian delegation was formatted, where is your agency, where, how you did you participate in this, and so on, please.
Thank you, Georgi. I'm always very glad to participate in all the communication between us and Checkpoints, especially because this is the audience that listens to the Georgian fresh news in English, and this is very important for the market. Yes, as you said, more than a year probably passed that we could not participate in the international exhibitions. And you know that international exhibitions for export and exporting companies is one of the best and most effective tool to reach their counterparts. So we've been able to go to Gulf Food, participate. 18 Georgian companies could take part. A good thing to mention is that 20% of the exhibition space was also granted to us, which means that we had more space for Georgian companies to exhibit their products. Also, the good thing is that this was the first exhibition, not just for a long time, but it was the first exhibition where we represented Georgian agro products with a very important national unified branding. So with the help of USAID Agri, we did a tremendous project which included branding Georgian agricultural products with concrete messages in it, which blends Georgian, let's say, organic nature of food, the fact that Georgian food is delivered by specific persons and specific farmers. So this is the concept. And also it's modern and manufactured and produced with modern technology. So the branding is called We Craft You Food. So this is the slogan. And we have a very amazing logo exhibiting all, let's say, Georgian products that we mainly export. So this is a very nice project, and we think that this will play a very important role in terms of understanding the Georgian products. The companies will have their own brand,
yeah,
but this will be unified under one umbrella, so it will be easier for, let's say, importers to understand the Georgian product, and also this is a very concrete market plan, marketing concepts everywhere. Let's say an importer goes to every exhibition, because at the same time, it's still the same society, right? Importers is a big society. So when they go to the exhibition, they already know what to expect and they already know what they're looking for. And this is very important for something to be remembered.
Right now, our viewers and followers had a chance while our conversation to follow the new branding, and as far as I know from yourself, while you were in, once again, my appreciations to USAID for their assistance and constant partnership and help of Georgia and all our agencies. So tell me, it looks like a bit how Chile was moving forward, correct, in this branding?
And already many other countries. I mean, Chile had a flashy slogan, that's why. But there are many countries who do that. And I think for the country who has a tradition of agri-product, especially, and a message to deliver, you need some kind of very concrete, nice branding, the slogan, because at the end of the day, they have to remember and they have to trust the brand. Trusting the national brand also gives credit to concrete companies and vice versa. So this is the flow.
Misha, tell me about the Gulf food. My pre-last question is again about Gulf food. I miss so much attendance on such events, yeah. But I'm really interested. What was the attendance in Dubai, where epidemiological situation is quite controlled, vaccination is so active, and at the same time it's well known. I think I know it from Producing Georgia agency memos that Gulf food is around 70,000 to 100,000 attendance and traffic of how was it in 2021 February?
Well, I think it's not surprising that the attendance of the visitors was decreased. It was 20% or 30% less. But the good thing to mention is that the quality of visitors was good, which means that the meetings were more efficient. And also the good thing is that with the help of Georgian Embassy in UAE, we scheduled very important meetings with big chains like Lulu, like Carrefour and Spar. So they had the opportunity, and it was attended by the procurement heads of these organizations, which means that they're concretely and specifically working on it. And they had the chance to meet with Georgian producers and to see Georgian products. I think this is very remarkable because it's
Our ambassador and embassy, they are doing great job there, worth to mention. My last question is about agency itself. Could you be so kind to update us a status about expert, not just promoting, but at the same time supporting with the traditional institutional tools, but at the same time, if there is anything what you should deliver to our business community?
So for the export plans for 2021, we hope that we're going to do another 11 international exhibitions. Of course, it is not solely dependent on us, but we think that taking into consideration the stages of vaccination and of the concrete countries, I think we will manage to have 11 international exhibitions. A part of that, you know, that we are planning to do 3 full-scale expert certificate courses. So this is a very concrete training program with a very concrete results. And at the end of the day, you get the certificate, which means that you are expert certified and you are knowledgeable. And of course, a thing to mention is definitely our Trade with Georgia platform, which has been renewed. And now Trade with Georgia is a go-to one and only platform from Enterprise Georgia for exporters, which means that all services are digitalized. They can use, exporters can use Trade with Georgia for exhibiting their products because there is a catalog, and then this is viewed to a very broad international society of importers. And of course, they have to also participate in the trainings, participate in the exhibitions through the platform. So their profile, so it's like, imagine it's their business profile that helps them with a lot of things. And one thing is that if you want to participate in our funded international exhibitions and training courses, they have to register. So this is how we kind of maintain the traffic, which is very important for the platform. This is very briefly about what we are going to do.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Let's keep in touch and let's update as much as we can our business community. Good luck to Producing Georgia. Personally, good luck, Misha. Thank you. And my best regards to your team. Bye.
Thank you.
Since we are talking about exports and Enterprise Georgia, let me bring in mega brands into this context here. Forbes will help me again to tell you about the global trend that brands continue to get on board with meatless products. Beyond Meat said it's secured multi-year deals with McDonald's and Yum! Brands, which owns Taco Bell, Pizza Hut, and KFC.
Yeah.
What's more, as part of a 3-year partnership with McDonald's, Beyond Meat will be the preferred supplier for the company's new plant-based burger, the McPlant. McDonald's wants the McPlant to be an entire platform that offers other menu items, such as plant-based options for chicken, pork, and egg. Let's see if this option also reaches Georgia as well. But before that, here is the video from Forbes.
As mainstream brands continue to get on board with meatless products, Los Angeles-based Beyond Meat said Thursday it's secured multi-year deals with McDonald's and Yum! Brands, which owns Taco Bell, Pizza Hut, and KFC, causing its shares to rise in after-hours trading despite a disappointing earnings report. As part of a 3-year partnership with McDonald's, Beyond Meat will be the preferred supplier for the company's new plant-based burger, the McPlant. McDonald's wants the McPlant to be an entire platform that offers other menu items, such as plant-based options for chicken, pork and egg. McDonald's introduced the McPlant last year in partnership with Beyond Meat and has tested it in Denmark and Sweden, but it had not committed to a long-term supplier. Yum! Brands offers a meatless Italian sausage pizza at Pizza Hut, and it said last year it was partnering with Beyond Meat to test plant-based items at Taco Bell, Pizza Hut and KFC stores in China. Under the deal announced Thursday, Beyond Meat said it will develop exclusive items for Pizza Hut, KFC and Taco Bell over the next several years. Beyond Meat shares rose 14% to $164 per share in after-hours trading on the announcements despite fourth-quarter earnings that fell short of analyst expectations. It reported a loss of 34 cents per share, compared to the consensus forecast of 13 cents per share, on $101.9 million in sales, below the consensus expectation for $103.2 million in sales. Beyond Meat's restaurant sales have suffered during the pandemic as eateries have struggled with restrictions on capacity and streamlined their menu offerings. Though grocery sales have dipped since the early pandemic boom, retail largely offset the decline in restaurant sales, the company said.
And Georgi, not only meat can be plant-based, but in this era of swift development, and especially in the technological field, we can combine part talkback radio, part conference call, part house party, and get a totally new social networking app based on audio chat.
And I know what that is. It's a clubhouse. It's a clubhouse. Users, users of iPhone and owners of iPad can listen in to conversations, interviews, and discussions between interesting people on various topics. It is just like tuning into a podcast, but live.
Yes, and let's just say it, Georgi, out loud. It has this added layer of exclusivity to it, since it is invite-only, which then means that you can't just download it off the App Store and create an account. It's like being a member of a closed club, like a golf club or something, but just virtually. So let's see what are some news with this clubhouse that our journalist, Anna Tavadze, put together for the Checkpoints.
About a month ago, a new social networking app, Clubhouse, appeared on the homepages of Georgian iPhone users. Dozens of chat rooms, thousands of users, and one activity of chatting via a platform that makes audio conversation comfortable, intimate, informal, boundless, and simple. A new obsession among Georgian users has emerged. So what is the story of Clubhouse? The invitation-only audio chat social networking iPhone app launched in April 2020. The app gained popularity in the early months of the COVID-19 pandemic by enabling users to listen into conversations, interviews, and discussions between interesting people on various topics. Just like tuning in to a podcast, but live, and with an added layer of exclusivity. Clubhouse grew significantly in popularity after Elon Musk was interviewed by the Good Time Club in January 2021. After that, he even tweeted at the official account of Russian President Vladimir Putin, asking for a conversation via Clubhouse. In May 2020, the app managed to be valued at nearly $100 million. On January 21, 2021, the valuation reached $1 billion. So how does it work? When a user joins, they select topics of interest like tech, books, business, or health. The more information the user gives the app about their interests, the more conversation rooms and individuals the app will recommend them to follow or join. Georgian users were quick to grasp the concept of the app and launch thematically diverse rooms. Mirian Jureli, who has vast experience in the communications field, was one of the first Georgian users to get into the stream.
And I believe it is very easy to start a conversation that you would like to start or to join a conversation. Therefore, I guess the keyword of all the features that Clubhouse has is the simplicity and easiness of just joining whatever you would like to join. And from the very first day I just fell in love, I realized that this would be a perfect place for me and people like me who would like to discuss things outside of their bubbles, outside of their friend circle. So I was like, maybe I should start a room immediately about whatever comes to my mind right now and see what happens. And suddenly a lot of people joined and I realized that that's the major factor why people actually sign up for Clubhouse. Something pops up to your head, you just open up the room and you see that I've hosted rooms that had, I don't know, like 300 people or something, I guess. So it's a really interesting experience. when you're thinking about something at your house or with your friends or something, you might start discussing it with them, and you know that there is a limited number of people, like your five friends around the table or something. And here, it's a complete surprise-based platform, I would say. Like, you open up a room and you don't know what's going to happen. Like, all sorts of random people might show up. They might discuss all sorts of random things. And I guess that's why I like it. It's the perfect explanation of what internet is about. You know, giving space to anybody to talk about anything they would like. I honestly believe that this platform is a great opportunity for not only businesses, but for organizations, for anybody to start a discussion about their product or about their service and get real live feedback from their customers or from their potential customers, or to discuss their ideas or to discuss their impact or to discuss something that they are planning to launch in a couple of weeks or a month, and just to tease it on the platform and see how people react.
Clubhouse has recently confirmed that it will be introducing products to help creators on the platform get paid, include subscriptions, tipping, and ticket sales. Of course, adding monetization for users also introduces a method for Clubhouse itself to monetize. Adding ways for users to pay other users provides an opportunity for Clubhouse to retain a cut for its services. The startup also announced that it will be starting work on its Android app and that it will also invest in more back-end scaling to keep up with the demand. In February 2021, Germany's largest consumer protection organization, the Federation of German Consumer Organizations, called on Clubhouse operator Alpha Exploration Co. to cease and desist from what is referred to as illegal business practices and data protection violations. Therefore, like with all tech giants, the way Clubhouse operates has raised questions among cybersecurity experts about some of the most pressing security and privacy issues that the app has. Giorgi Iashvili was one of them.
Firstly, we have to say that recording the audio chats. Recording the audio chat, what does it mean? So by privacy, the agreement and what we see when we try to get more knowledge regarding the application, we say that they say, the vendor company, the Alpha Exploration and Co., which owns the Clubhouse application and which operates this app, they say that the recording of the audio is only active when the chat room, specific chat room, is live. So the ability of recording is only active and only valid while the chat room is active and chat room is in live. So that's the one thing what they say. And also they say that the application uses end-to-end encryption. So for the audio chat, so no one can understand, no one can intercept any kind of audio, like chat containments. On the one hand, they say that they do have the encryption of the audio messages, and they don't have the ability to read it. And in the second point, they say that they are able to read, but they say it indirectly, of course, that they are able to read and to understand and to make all the things clear for the investigative purposes. People are not keen on the restricted things, and people are keen on trendy things. So when something appears, for example, why it's popular here in Georgia, not in Georgia, like in other parts of the world as well, the whole earth is they're really, really happy with the Clubhouse, and it's too trendy because of Elon Musk, because of Mark Zuckerberg, and so on. So I can't predict, but I do believe it. I do love to see Clubhouse to reach the level of development what we have, the already classic and traditional social networks. So I'm in team of Clubhouse, but only considering the cyber risks and privacy risks, and to using this application within the security measures.
The unexpected rise of Clubhouse continues to draw the attention of Silicon Valley's social media giants, with Twitter rolling out Spaces replicating the Clubhouse experience, with Facebook working to add live audio features to its existing products, and Spotify experimenting with live podcasting tools. Clubhouse will have to work hard to remain competitive and keep providing unique conversation and communication experience to its users.
Maybe you'll hear us in the Clubhouse quite soon as well, who knows.
But before that,
it's time to say goodbye. Sorry about that. And let me remind you to follow us on BMG and Forbes.g for always being updated and trusted information to receive and, of course, analysis.
And somehow it has turned into a new tradition for the checkpoints to leave you off with a video, inspirational one this time. March is said to be Women's Month. So here are the 9 richest women in America in 2020. See you on Sunday.
And hope to come back once quite soon with the same video about Georgian women.
That's
10
so
p.m. sharp, as Elena likes to end. So
thank
see you.
You
soon and enjoy the video.